Somebody ought to throw your hands up and say, Father. Woo! This is old school. I stretch. Online, sing this. My hands. Sing it the old way. Come on. To me. No. Sing it old school. The will withdraw. Young people, learn this. Thyself from me. Oh, well, the I go, I need, come on, the all I need. You might have some saints in here. Every hour I need thee. Ten of y'all should have stepped out your seat already. Oh, breath. Me now, myself, woo! Savior, I come. This is Sunday morning service to be. This time I need full participation. I need. Come on, everybody. Be all I need thee. Only sing this if you need them. Every hour I need thee. The old folks say, oh, bless. Oh, bless. Oh, bless. Bless me now, my Savior. Under 30, lift your hands. I come to thee. Oh, shucks, I feel like it's Sunday. Somebody say, yeah. 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 If God brought you out of anything, then push your neighbor in the back and say, he brought me out.
He brought me out.
Oh, he brought me out. If you've been through anything in your life, if he helped you with your children, if you've ever been broke, if you've ever been stuck in something, then push two people and say, he made a way.
He made a way.
He made a way. Amen. I'm gonna read my opening text, but before I do, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Come on.
Try to Come on, bless his name. Come on, bless him. To God be the glory. Hey. At the end of this sermon, I want to spend some time, if it's all right, with a few of you in intercession. Is that okay? Yeah. Jesus said, shh. A lot of people don't know this, but Jesus did not say, my church will be called a house of the praise team. He didn't even say, my house should be called a house of preaching. That's not what he said. He said, my house shall be called a house of prayer. And I called George last night and I said, have somebody pray during worship. Yeah, let's make sure that we don't get through a service and somebody don't pray. Yeah, old school church used to have altar call. I started to have one this morning. I might still have one where you just came to the altar before the pastor preached and just said, because in, outsiders, y'all looking at me, teenagers, and pastor, why are you always doing that? Because grown people got enough sense to look right at you. Yeah, life then beat the hell out you. Look at somebody, say, it's not cussing. Say, life beat the hell out of me. Tell somebody, that's not cussing. Yeah, you can say it just like that. Yeah, that's in the Bible. That's in the Bible. But teenagers, you know, I remember we would be in church, and I ain't gonna lie, sometimes we'd be kind of half asleep or playing or writing little letters. Do you think Raynell is cute? Yes or no? I never got quite a yes. And young people, this was pre-phone, where to pass time in church, you would do the rating game. Rate Raynell 1 to 7. I got like a 4 on my best day. When I had a curl, I got 6. But so to the teenagers, I'm intentional to say stuff to them so that they sort of look at me and remember saying, when pastor would preach, I used to pay attention. So I appreciate that. But I say that to say, and I'm purposely going slow today. We all know the elephant in the room is what happened last night in Buffalo. And if you don't know, you know, I'll be talking about all that, just unnecessary shootings and killings. And as a pastor, my spidey senses go up. Because you say how many died, I then say how many went to heaven. Yeah, all of us gonna die. Tomorrow, next week, 2047, we gonna leave here. But do you know Jesus? And so, you know, you can write your little cute sermon and you're ready to preach, and then you wake up to that and it's like, God, what are you saying? I spent like 10 hours on this, but yet, is there something else I gotta add? And so, is there an addendum? And so, I just feel prayer. So, we're gonna save some time. And to my online audience, let me say this before I preach. I don't do this much talking before I preach, but let me pastor. Let me be the pastor, okay? Just let me be the pastor. And I wanna say to all of you, at 6 o'clock tonight, if you're watching this, I want you to be on that Zoom. Drop it in the chat now. I want to talk to everybody who goes to our church virtually and share my heart with you. My girl will be on. Some of our team members will be on. That's going to help me to pastor you properly. So we're just so excited. So if you could just please, it's in the chat. Take a picture of it. Be on that Zoom tonight. We'll send you an email to everybody whose email we have. One other thing I want to say, and then I'm going to tag this text. You've been standing too long. Wait a minute. And that is, we gave you some cards coming in the door. And Pastor, what's those cards about? That's not marketing. Look around. Even in a pandemic, I think they told me 12, 13, 14,000 people watched me preach last Sunday. Amen, everybody. Those cards I gave you are for you to be a blessing. It's called Alive Weekend. Say alive. Every third weekend, we want to do something to make us come alive. So that card you got, if you can afford it, when you go to dinner today, pay for the car in back of you. Say, give them this card. Whatever level you are, if not, give it to a homeless person. And make sure you just drop. Could you use your phone and look at the back of the QR code? And if they do that, they're going to get the gospel message that Jesus lives from Lady Vernon and I. Amen. So the only mistake you can make is to come back next Sunday with those cards still in your pocket or in your purse, because that means you didn't give them away. So just bless people. Just pay for a toll and say, can I pay for the toll behind me? Hand them this card. And whoever looks at that, who knows if somebody might get saved because of your card more than my preacher. Also, we told you that every third Friday, every third Sunday, we're going to bless the church. And Pastor Larry Howard of the historic Greater Friendship Church, you're going to love this, who is Rich Paul's pastor. Maybe you don't know that. LeBron's agent, all his family goes there. He did his mother's funeral. And so 50 years of pastoring next week. 50 years. And the Word Church is going to bless them, if it's okay, with $1,000 or so. Is that all right to say thank you? And so I'm doing something I ain't did in a long time. I'm going to a banquet next Sunday. His 50-year banquet. I'm a preacher. Then go to the banquet. Me and Lady Vernon with our banquet clothes on. You got a hat, baby? I need you to get a hat. Somebody get Lady Vernon a church hat. We going to the banquet. Mother Williams, hook her up. We going to the banquet. Amen. All right. You've been standing long enough. Let me read this. I'll take some off my sermon. One last thing. Everybody who helped with the Blackish and the Easter service, all that, I got dinner for you after church. Would y'all clap for them, everybody? Come on. So we are serious. And so Lady Vernon and I just want to have dinner, man. That Easter service, that Blackish series was so awesome. Man, come on. They deserve it. So let's have big dinner today right after church down in our fireside chapel. All right, here it is. Acts 27:34. But I urge you to eat something now. You'll need strength for the rescue ahead. Uh-oh. You're going to come out of this without even a scratch. You're going to come out of this without even a scratch. Come on, let's go hip-hop this weekend. Push five people and say, you're going to be all right. Go ahead, praise somebody. No, push somebody else and say, we gonna be all right. We gonna be all right. Go ahead and take your seats in the Lord's house. All right. Something interesting. One of these trivia questions. What do pastors 40 to 50 years old have in common? We are the first generation of pastors who were reared and raised on the hip-hop genre. Trip on that. The pastors before us were raised on Motown. The pastors before them were raised on the blues of B.B. King and Bobby Blue Bland. But us guys that were born early 70s, 80s, were the first generation of pastors that were raised on hip-hop, MTV, and BET. We are the first generation of pastors and parents who like the same music our children do. Previous to us, it was like two different worlds, but we were raised on hip hop. I guess if you wanted to differentiate us from the new school, we would call it old school hip hop. Yeah, show me your little baby. I'll show you my EPMD. Show me your Kendrick Lamar. I'll show you my KRS-One. Show me your Drake, I'll show you. Throw something out, somebody. Whichever one you want, praise God, amen. He said Dana Dane, real old school, amen. Show me your Drake, I'll show you my Rock Kemp and Eric B. All I'm saying is we were reared and raised on hip hop, so all of us were happy as we could be to find out that during this year's halftime ceremony, they were featuring old school hip hop. I sat there and I watched Eminem drop, you know, If You Only Had One Shot. I watched Snoop and Dre make it do what it do. Old school Mary J. I was mad she ain't sing Real Love. Come on now. Even had 50 Upside Down singing in the club. But then what might have been underestimated is Kendrick Lamar was handed the mic, who probably had the best entourage behind him in terms of look and style. And he sung a song that I was not familiar with, and that is, We Gonna Be All Right. When I heard We Gonna Be All Right, I thought that has tremendous preaching possibilities. And so I went and looked it up and saw that I could not preach the regular version. I was so happy that Ty Tribbett took it and gave it a gospel Jesus flair. So when you Google it, do not Google Kendrick Lamar's, but Google Ty Tribbett's. I say that to say this text speaks to us about the issue on the table of what's happening in our world today, particularly in light of what happened just last evening. One can drop his head. One can become pessimistic about the state of the world. Depending on what you're going through, even in your family, sometimes everything wrong. It seems like everybody you love is making crazy decisions, children, spouses, you name it, it's happening. Coupled with that, there's the financial stuff that goes with life. And what about those of us in the sandwich years where kids are getting grown and making their mistakes and then parents are getting older, so you feel like you're sandwiched between two realities? Can I suggest to you, in spite of everything happening, God sent me with a prophetic word, and that is, we're gonna be all right. If God be for us, who can be against us? This particular Lucan text, you do know Luke wrote the book of Acts. You could almost call Acts second Luke. Acts is a powerful book written by the physician Luke. And in it, he chronicles one of Paul's journeys. I promise I won't be a long time. Let me set some context so you can really respect the content. It is in Acts 27, if you read verses 1 through 10, that the apostle Paul is again a prisoner. He's a prisoner, this time on a ship headed to Italy. He's not doing what Lady Vernon and I did, intentionally going to Italy so that we can look up and see the Sistine Chapel, not just on Google, but in person. What a moment. He's not on vacation like Lady Vernon and I in Italy, but rather he is a prisoner who's been taken captive and made to go to Italy. Here's what's amazing. Even though he's a prisoner, he's still prophetic. Even though he's a prisoner, he's still pastoral. He's on this ship with a group of guys, and the captain is headed to Italy. That's the destination, and they're jumping from boat to boat, trying to figure out how to get there. And Paul says something that opens up our text, and I need all of you to pay attention. It's right there on the screen. He opens in verse 10 and 11 by saying, "Men," he said, "I believe there is trouble ahead. If we go on, shipwreck, loss of cargo, and danger to our lives, but the officer in charge of the prisoners listened more to the ship's captain than to Paul." Watch this. But they listened more to the ship's captain and the owner of the vessel than to Paul. Here's the first question. Those of you who like learning, here it is. Whose voice do you value? Whose voice do you value? Can I tell you that your success in life to a great extent will be based on whose voice you value? With all of these, you'll love this colliding voices, this confluence of colliding voices coming in your ears. Whose voice do you value? Can I tell you the benefit of pastoring some 22 years, 23 if you add my first church, I'm starting to have people walk up to me and say, "Pastor, you was right." I'm starting to have people that I help raise, people who love me. "I should have listened to you." Can I tell you something that can save you some time? Watch whose voice you value. If you happen to have a mama that halfway loved Jesus and come to church, and a father, value her voice. I'm starting to do something that's important to me. I told you this. It might be the quote of the year, and you slept on it. I told you, when people don't listen, stop talking. That might have been the best thing I told you. I'm in a place in my life, if all of my years of experience and mistakes and leading thousands of people and having a pretty decent marriage and raising some pretty decent children, if that's not enough for you to value my voice, I'd rather save my voice for someone who values it. I don't want any more wasted conversations. I'm much less patient. I don't beg people to listen to me. I know the value of my voice. My voice is worth more than $1 million. Y'all just missed that. I'm sorry, lean on somebody and say, "You don't know who you sit next to." Go ahead, y'all just missed that. No, I've been through enough. You ought to tell your children and your grandchildren, value my voice, because this is a voice that has been built on the foundation of mistakes. What I just said is so cold-blooded. Yet this voice has learned at the school of hard knocks. This this voice has experience, and so he says to them, here it is, don't y'all miss this. He says, I don't think we should take this trip. I know y'all think I'm just a lowly prisoner, but I'm the Apostle Paul. I'm the man of God. I hear from God. God changed my life. And the Spirit of God is telling me to tell you that we should not take this trip. Maybe y'all think I'm just a brother here who's a prisoner, a nobody. But I'm saying to you, Captain, I'm saying to the owner of this vessel, I suggest we do not. Number one, the season of sailing was over. We're probably going to run into a storm. The Bible says they decided to go anyway. Here it is, verse 13 says, and a light wind began blowing from the south. I start shouting in my house. Let me ask a question. Who loves the word of God? Raise your hand. And a light wind start blowing, just a little smooth wind, just sit on your porch wind, just summer, summer, summertime, just... And a light wind, watch this. Okay, here's your first shout. Verse 13 says a light wind, but then the very next verse says, and the weather changed abruptly. Y'all just missed that. Y'all pray for me. I love the Bible. Certain stuff I read, Matthew, I just start shouting in my house. First it says a light wind. Very next verse says, and the weather changed abruptly. Most of the time, a storm is not subtle, it's sudden. Yeah, most of the time you don't see it coming. The Bible says there was a light wind. Some of you have been dealing with some little light stuff, and all of a sudden you get one call and the weather changed. You thought your marriage was one thing, one text, and the weather changed. I'm preaching to somebody. You thought your kids were one thing and found out that the weather could change. Can I tell you why you ought to hold to God's unchanging hand? Push somebody and say, the weather might change. Go ahead. Oh, the Bible says... The Bible says, huphaneo, huphaneo in the Greek. I only use Greek when it's necessary. Huphaneo, that means a light wind. As a matter of fact, the New King James, the New American Standard calls it a moderate wind. Moderate in the Greek, all right? Huphaneo, it is something light, but it went from that to tukaneos. Now, y'all just missed y'all shout. Because that means stormy, tempestuous. Do you know in life you can go from Hukania to Tucanillo in 2 seconds? Okay, y'all not having church with me. Maybe your phone don't work. Maybe your phone is cut off. Maybe you don't have a television. But if you have either of what I just said, then you know that just yesterday, whenever you're watching this, maybe it's already passed, but just yesterday in Buffalo, somebody said, I'm going to the store, baby. I'll be right back. I'm going to get a loaf of bread, pick up some milk. She said, okay, baby, I'll be here when you get back. Walked in the store, and some deranged, demonically influenced brother with racial issues took out his gun and shot everybody that looked black in the store, and 10 people lost their lives. It went from a light wind to a storm. Can I tell you something? Can I tell you why I'm sitting in church? I don't know why you're sitting in church. Can I tell you why I need Jesus? Can I tell you why I'm not going to get so caught up in my business or my money or my wife or my husband? Because I realize I can go from Hufania to Tucanias. I wished I had 10 people, but that's why the old folk used to say, be very sure that your anchor will hold and grip a solid rock. Can I tell you who the rock is? This rock is Jesus. He's the only one. Can I tell you who this rock is? His name is Jesus, God's only son. Be very sure that your anchor will hold. The Bible says it went from a light wind. Watch this. I'm not trying to be pessimistic. Don't walk around being fearful. Walk around with the joy of the Lord. But do be cognizant of this reality. Life can go from a light wind to a storm in 2 seconds. Your life can go from a light wind to a storm. Can I tell you, Pastor, what are you sure about one thing? Pastor, what are you sure about one thing? That your kids are going to be great? No, I'm not sure about that. The Lady Vernon is never going to leave you? No, I'm not sure about that. I don't think so, but if she doesn't leave me, death will take her one day, or death will take me. We're going to separate. I'm only sure of one thing. I didn't turn 51. Y'all better shout. I'm only sure of one thing. I'm only sure of one thing. It's up to you to shout. I'm only sure of one thing in this world, that he'll never leave you. Woo! Somebody. Somebody that's been through divorce, Somebody that's had death in your family, somebody that has been through some tough times should be a witness with Pastor that the only thing I know for sure is that Jesus Christ is Lord of Lords and King of Kings, and you better make sure. Verse 20, I got to go, for many days we could not see the sun or the stars. That was for somebody right there who didn't shout. For many days we couldn't see the sun or the stars. The storm was very bad. Wait a minute, we lost all hope. Y'all missed y'all shout. For many days, this is not for everybody, but it is for somebody. For somebody, it's been dark a long time. For somebody, whatever else I'm learning, it is to preach incrementally to everybody, because somebody here, life is not perfect. It's been storming for many days. Watch this. And the Bible says, we had lost all hope of staying alive. We had lost all hope. Can I tell you what the devil's after? Your hope. If I can get your hope, a hopeless man is a sad man. Yeah, I keep telling you, you don't have to be around me. You don't have to have something to be around me, but you do have to want something. Yeah, because once you lose your hope, your hope, my beautiful white brother from another mother, Pastor Rod Parsley, major pastor, mega church in Columbus, Ohio. His son suffers with autism, and he said something that made me throw money at the computer. He said, my baby had autism some 22, 23 years ago. We went to the doctor, and the doctor said, clearly, we want to tell you a few things, and it's our job to tell you. We've done the best we can. He said, I understand. Then they said, there's nothing else we can do. He said, I understand. But then thirdly, they said, there's no hope. He said, wait a minute. Let me try this one more time. They said, we've done the best we can. He said, I understand. They said, there's nothing else we can do. He said, I understand. But then the doctor made the mistake of saying, there is no hope. He said, wait a minute. Now you're talking above your pay grade, because my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. You can't tell me not to hope. I don't care what the doctor said. I don't care what's happening with your child. We hope in something bigger than us, and we have a faith that says, no matter how bad the storm, go and push somebody and say, I'm coming out of this. Go ahead. The enemy is after your hope. I came to preach to somebody who the devil's been messing with, telling you that you shouldn't even hope. No, keep believing God. The business shall happen. Yeah, God does have a plan for your life romantically, if that's his will. You keep hoping based on what God spoke to you. You don't let nobody tell you what you can or cannot do. As a matter of fact, I keep hearing, let's have church. Three or four people, don't get nervous, this happens every 3 or 4 years. Three or four of you sitting right here right now then came up to me with that cancer thing. I get it. What did I tell you? Same thing I'm telling you. Do everything the doctor tells you, but trust in the Lord. Can I just prophesy over somebody dealing with any kind of mental or physical sickness? Come on, let's tear the church up. 23 people say, we're going to be all right. Go ahead. No. God has a plan. The very next verse is on the screen. Paul does something that we teach people not to do pastorally, psychologically, sociologically. It's something that we teach. Paul has an I told you so moment. He says it. Be careful, because some things we tell people not to say, the Bible says. Because Paul says, when the storm came, he says, told y'all not to go. It's right there on the screens. I couldn't make it up. Paul says, I told you. I'm sorry. Do me a favor. When your mama has told you not to do something for 12 years, when your best friend told you for 8 years, girl, don't do that. When everybody that loves you told you, give them at least 5 minutes to have an I told you so moment. Praise God. I mean, why are you going to throw up my past? Because I told your behind. I mean, give everybody 5 minutes. Give everybody 5 minutes. When you told somebody something repeatedly, don't do that. He crazy. He just like the other one. Don't date him. He's not right. You don't understand him. No, you don't understand him. We all understand him. You're the only one crazy in this equation. Everybody else completely understand him except you. At least give everybody 5 minutes, just one conversation of I told you so. Paul said, I told y'all. Paul, this is the Apostle Paul, not pastor. The Apostle Paul says, I told y'all not to go. Told you. But it is as though, are y'all tired of me?
No.
Somebody say, teach, pastor, teach.
Yeah.
It is as though, and I see this in several places in Paul's writing and articulation, it is as though he catches himself mid-thought and wants to write himself. I don't know, this is eisegetical, but it's what I see in the text, because the very next verse, Paul says, where I says, but there's no need to dwell on that now. I love the Bible. He says, okay, told y'all not to go. Told you not to marry him. Told you not to marry him. Told you not to take that job. Told you to finish that degree. Told you don't try that drink, because drinking runs in our family. I told you. But it is as though, somebody said, preach to us, pastor. Praise God. But it is as though Paul catches himself and writes himself mid-sentence and says, but let's don't trip on that. It's done now. That's a word for seven people. To those of you that tend to bring up people's stuff too much, go on and make your statement and let it go. There's not a thing I can do about what I've done back there. There's not a thing I can do about who I used to be married to. There's not a thing I can do about who I've been to bed with. There's not a thing I can do about choices I made. And so Paul says, don't dwell on that. I don't know who this word is for, but to everyone who the enemy tries to regurgitate your past every 5 days in your mind, you got to get to a place where you are an encourager and not a discourager. And you can look at even your children and say, no, but don't dwell on that. That's all right. Be a better mother for the second baby than you was the first baby. So what, you weren't married? The baby is a blessing. The sex was a sin. That's all right. Get yourself together. Finish that degree. And let's get this thing done. Come on, brother. So what, you got a felony? I was out of town this week. Took Lady Vernon on a quick creep move for Mother's Day. Found out one of my best daughters in this church applied to get her felony removed from her record. And the state said, no, don't even know. She's like the coldest woman in my church now. 2-3 degrees, cold-blooded job, keeping herself absent the last 13 years. And one mistake in her life, something stupid she did when she was 20, and they won't take it off her record, which is kind of holding her back from a job she wants now. And she was tripping. I called her from vacation. This is God. I called her from vacation and says, God told me to call you and tell you, don't dwell on that. Y'all just missed y'all shout. I don't know who this word is for, but the enemy keeps bringing up one thing that you wish you could have back. One night you wish you could change. If you can't change it, don't dwell on it. Forgetting those things which are behind. Paul says, don't dwell on that. All of you that have done something that you're just not proud of, don't dwell on it. You losing time talking about the money you could have made. It's too much money to be made now. I can get me some more money. I just can't get me no more time. I got to work it while it's day, because night is coming when no man can work. This is your season not to look back, but to do your thing. Somebody old jump up and say, I got to do my thing. Tonight, if God say the same, my girl will tell you, I'll be on a conference call with hundreds of pastors across this country who, for whatever reason, come to Cold Cleveland every year and call us their leaders. One of the things I'm going to tell them is that I teach them more from my mistakes than I do my victories. I hit them with what I shouldn't have done, financial decisions we shouldn't have made, places I wasn't patient, things I would have done differently. And I quickly tell them, but I ain't got time for that. That's what I did. Don't you do that. Now, let me tell you what we're doing now. We're changing the game virtually. We got thousands of people watching all across the world. The whole mentality and culture has changed. It's better here now than it's ever been before. God has taken that stuff and put it in the small of his back, and now he can't even see it. I'm sorry. Don't bother your neighbor after this for at least 2 minutes, but do me a favor. Look at two people and say, how come you keep remembering what God forgot? Go ahead and tell somebody. If God forgot it, don't you bring it up no more. It's under the blood. It is gone. It is done. All right. Here's your shout. If you want to shout, shout. If you don't, just sit there. Then Paul said, from now on, things are looking up. All this is in the Bible. All you have to do, preachers, is preach the text. Let the text talk. Things are looking up. I don't know who this is for. Six of y'all haven't moved yet. I'm going to try it one more time. I don't know what 2021 was. I don't know what the first 6 months or first 5 months of this month have been, but I got a prophetic word for 10 people that are living right, giving right, trying to walk up right. Things are looking up. How do you know it? Let's tear the church up. Here it is. When I read this, some of you, this word is for you. To those watching from Buffalo, New York, those watching in that place and geography of tragedy, God sent me to tell you, how do you know it, Paul? He says, it's on the screens. Try not to run completely around the church. Last night, an angel of the Lord talked to me and said, don't be afraid, Paul. Because you have to stand trial before Caesar. Now read Acts 27 later. To Bible lovers, read Acts 27 and 28. Just two cold-blooded texts. When he gets to Malta, all that stuff, bit by the snake, cold-blooded teaching. Don't have time for all of it. It's not my assignment. Paul says, how do you know we're going to make it? Because last night, an angel came to me and said, I have to stand before Caesar. So, if I gotta stand before Caesar and I'm on the boat, then that means everybody on the boat with me got to live, because if y'all go down, I'm going down. I'm sorry, has it been 2 minutes? 46 people say, I can't die right now, go ahead. Woo! What I just said should have made somebody shout. I know I got to die one day, but I can't die right now. There's too much destiny in me. There's too much possibility in me. Somebody watching online, have church with me. God told me to tell you, way in California, Atlanta, I'll talk to you tonight, in New York, Alabama, Detroit, you cannot die right now. You shall live and not die to declare the works of the Lord. Why? Because there's a word over your life, and until you complete that word, until you complete what God has called you to do, you cannot die. What's more is on the screens. Baby, the text says, I'm going to be an expository preacher till I go to heaven. I'm going to be an expository. This is called the Word Church. We preach the word, not opinion. If it's not in the text, I try not to talk. The text says, what's more, everybody's sailing with you. God has granted his goodness and safety to everyone. How are you not shouting? One of my homiletic heroes, I'm having preachers soon, Dr. Philip Pointer, a Virginia Union graduate, one of my homiletic heroes, new up-and-coming expository preacher who's killing the game. He said, I'm trying to teach St. Mark, that's the name of his church, how to shout on the Bible. He says, before I even explain it, I just want them to love the word so much that as soon as I read the text, thank you, Dr. Pointer, as soon as I read the text, they just go to shout. So let me try this one more time. I'm granting safety to everyone sailing with you. Okay. I told y'all this 5 years ago, but I traveled the length and breadth of this country preaching, and my guys, normally I take Larry or one of the guys, I take George to go with me, and there's this thing, normally the church will be kind enough to me to put me in first class, and I'll say, if you can, put my guys in first class, but if not, put them as close as you can. We won't demand that, but if you can. Sometimes they do, a lot of times they don't. But Larry and George have learned something that's amazing. When I get in line in first class, they just get behind me. And so I always show my ticket, and then I walk on. And then I always look back to make sure they're okay. I've never gotten on a plane without them, and I never will. Always look back to make sure they're cool. And both of them look at the lady and say, "We with him." Y'all just missed that phrase. I wished I had somebody that would shout because, okay. I don't know who I'm preaching to, but I wished I had somebody that knows, be careful who you hang with. Okay, here's your shout. I wrote this: you need the right connection for your inevitable defection. Now what, that's too deep. I'm preaching better than you responded. You need the right connection for your inevitable defection, because sometimes you're gonna defect from your prayer life, defect from your faith walk, defect from right living, but you need the right connection for your defection so that even when you're not right, they still right. Which means my best friend should be somebody who knows how to have a little talk with Jesus so that when I can't get to God, they can get to God. I'm sorry. Ask 8 people, who you with? Go ahead. Who you with? Who you with? Minister Josh, you need the right connection for your inevitable defection. I'm gone. Okay. And so Paul said, okay, I'm out of time. He says, so take courage. This is just all Bible. For I believe God. I'm going to teach you how to shout on the scripture. I don't have to explicate it. As soon as I say it, by the time I'm done, Lord, let me pastor here at least 10 more years. By the time I'm done, as soon as I read the Bible, some scriptures ought to make you jump without hesitation. He says, I believe God that it shall turn out just as he said. One more time. I believe God. Ooh, you ought to look at 6 of your kids and say, I believe God. The Lord spoke to me about you, little brother, when I was rubbing you in my stomach. I prayed over you, little brother, before you could even kick good. And the Lord gave me a word over your life. And even though, where my mother's at, even though you're not walking in it yet, I believe God that it shall turn out. Take 30 seconds and preach and praise him for what hasn't even happened yet. Somebody. He says, I believe God. But then right after that kind of unction, he hits me with a conjunction. Because the next verse says, but. Baby, give me some money to give myself an offering. I left all my money. Do you have any cash on you? Because sometimes you got to give yourself an offering. Because after that kind of prophetic unction, then Luke tells us that Paul hits them with a conjunction. English majors come here. I think we know that, but here we are, 40 and over. Conjunction, junction, what's your function? Wonder Twin Powers activate. Come on, players! My kids back there like, he is so corny. He is so corny. I'll hear about that later. Here we go. He says, but, put that scripture up, we will be shipwrecked on an island. We're going to be shipwrecked on an island. I want to know, why is that in the Bible? How come you just can't tell us, Paul, that it's going to be cool in the gang? Why you got to tell me that I'm gonna get wrecked? I just want you to tell me, but we will be shipwrecked. I'm trying to figure out, why come I gotta go through some wrecks? why do I have to get wrecked? And I got to thinking about Psalms 139. Don't turn. Don't even worry about it. You all know it. Lord, you have searched me and know me. You know my going out and my coming in. You know my sitting down and my uprising. The psalmist says, such knowledge is too wonderful for me. He says, where can I go from your spirit, or where can I flee from your presence? If I take wings and fly to the uttermost parts of the earth, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, you are there. Pastor, what are you trying to say? I guess all I'm trying to tell you is that he knows me. He said, you have searched me and known me. This might be the best part of my sermon, and it's at the end. Come here, come here. This might be the best part of my sermon. There's always the God moment. Here it is. This might be the best part of my sermon. You have searched me and known me. You know my going out and my coming in. You know me on the inward parts. It's too wonderful for me cognitively and searching by me. Please catch this. What he's saying is, you know me. And so I wrote this because I wanted to make sure, Jennifer, that I didn't say it wrong. So I wrote it. It was so important to me that I wrote, often it's my spirituality and personality that have major impact on my existential reality. It gets better. Sometimes my idiosyncrasies have impact on my misery and my tragedies. If you want that, I'll send you the notes or whatever. But here's what I'm trying to tell you. What I'm trying to tell you is, why shipwreck and why me? Because he know me. And spirituality says, if my spirituality is mature enough for no tragedy, then Lord, keep it from me. But if the only way to draw me to you, because some people praise God better in trouble. I don't know who I'm talking to. Some people worship God better out of tragedy. Some of you know, watch this, that God has to give you enough sunshine not to go crazy. But if he gives you too much, you go crazy. This is too good. He got to give you enough good days so you don't lose your mind. But sometimes when things go well too long, when pandemics hit and you ain't been to church since, but you're at every amusement park and mall in the country and been on vacation 3 times, but church is not safe. I'm sorry. Please keep watching me. Keep watching me. I gotta say, God, have your way in my life, because you know how much I can handle. And so sometimes God got to wreck me to correct me. But I need some people mature enough to say, God, whatever you gotta do to my wife and I, whatever you gotta let happen to draw me closer to you, I trust you with my life, with my children, with my wife. Have your way, Lord, in my life. Paul says, we may have to get shipwrecked. Okay, Lord, have your way. As I predicted and prophesied, the storm came. I'm done. What am I, 36? Gotta stop. As predicted and prophesied, the storm came, and their sailor instincts told them to abandon the ship. But Paul says something profound in the next verse, and it's all I got time for. The next verse says, it's right there. Paul says, I recommend to all of you, unless these men stay with the ship, you cannot be saved. Look at me. Paul says, I want to tell you something powerful. Their sailor instincts, these are professional sailors. They're not novice. They're not weekend players. No, these are novice. And Paul says, as they're, let me come on this side. Y'all not saying amen. Okay, I'll come back. Last chance. See, that's why I got wheels. Because if you don't love me, I'll roll out. See, I'll be gone. I created that. Ask everybody. I created that. Then nobody in the country had the wheels, but I did so I can roll out from people who don't say amen. I'm just playing. I love y'all. Here's what I'm saying. Their sailor instinct said, abandon ship. When sailors jump off a ship, the storm bad. I wish I had time to unearth and unpack this. I would panic at the first lightning. Okay? But these are professional sailors who knows when it's a passing storm, Abandoned ship means, don't look at this as a cute story. The ship is acting crazy. It's that Titanic type thing. It's flipping. Cargo's being thrown off. There's panic. Everything's happening. And Paul says, I got a word. Stay on the ship. This is not even for everybody. The reason why I want to talk to you tonight, the reason why to the thousands and thousands that are watching me virtually, if you assign to the word, you can't leave. There are some people, I would have never said this 20 years ago, that should leave. God, you don't hear me. If you, your children, your mama, your daddy, your wife, your husband, don't honor and feel me, feel her, feel what we're doing, if there's no divine connection, who the real phony? Because I want to be here. Y'all not hearing me. But if you call to me, this hit me last night. Pastor, but one time you got on my nerves. Well, you got on mine too. Here's something deep. I couldn't have a captain or a coach that never bothered me. This is too good. No. I got friends for that. Sometimes I need my leader to push me, to irritate me, to get on my nerves a little bit, to challenge me, to correct me. But that's not enough. Well, Pastor, but I got offended by one of the ushers. Well, your mama said some nastier stuff than that, and you went over there for Mother's Day. Your auntie and them cuss each other out every other week. But y'all stay together. Three of your cousins owe you money now, and they was just over your house like they didn't owe you no money. And you ain't left them. But as soon as the church does one thing, I'm offended. I feel offended. No, you have to take offense. And I'm not letting the enemy let me take no offense. They went out from us because they were not of us. Had they been, I wished I had seven people. This is not preacher talk. I'm not even trying to shout you. As a matter of fact, I had you where I wanted you. And for me to stop and preach this, some would say, why? Because it's my assignment. There are many of you, you're called to us. There are thousands of you that are not. And there are other great churches who do as well as we do in their own flow. But there's something in my mouth and her hug and our leaders that God has called you to. And there are people that have walked up to me and said, Pastor, I'm leaving today. They'll tell you. And I blessed them and said, I understand. There are others I said, I'm not sure. I think there's something I'm hearing that you're called here. Yeah, over the pandemic, we got emails such and such quick for no reason. I said, got it. Never really sensed that connection anyway. But then there are others where you think, no, there's something in this place. It's not even just about me. It's about what God is doing in this place. There's a word in my mouth that keeps you right. There's a word that keeps you challenged. There's something in her embrace and Elder Drita and the leaders and Elder Reno and all these team and Brother Matt, all these people that touch you and hug you. I got a word for you, even during this pandemic, stay on the ship. Don't abandon ship. Don't abandon ship. Stay connected. I'm gone when I tell you, here it is, but I urge you, I'll just cut some off. All right, I got to go back one. So the soldiers, verse 32, just give me 2 minutes. So the soldiers, never saw this in 30 years, cut the lifeboats. Tammy, are any of you listening to me? Do you see the seven sermons in this sermon? All the preachers that, all these years, I never saw this. So the soldiers cut the lines to the lifeboats. Do you understand how major that was? They were lowering the lifeboats, which was their final way of staying alive, which is why all cruise ships have enough lifeboats for every passenger on board according to the law. There has to be enough lifeboats that all 3,000, if the ship goes down, can get into a lifeboat. By law. They cut the lines, which said to God, you all I got. The reason why some of you have not went to your next level, because you haven't cut some stuff. Y'all missed that. God says, as long as you got a plan B, you can't have me fully. God says, you got to trust in the Lord and lean not to your, I'm preaching to somebody. You can't have your woman in case this girl don't work out. You can't have two women. This free singles, never date two people at the same time. No, date one person and eliminate them as soon as they don't have the potential to be your spouse. Because singles don't play date when they save. Many of you, there's one line you haven't cut, which means God says, until you put full faith in me. I was talking to one of the young people, you have sex with somebody and you weren't protected, or just in case, there's a pill called Plan B, which means take it the next day. I don't like Plan B the next day. I like Plan A, abstinence. Cut the line. I'ma wait on the Lord. Are y'all hearing me, everybody? All right, I'm gone. Here it is, last verse. Thank you for your patience, but I urge all of you, let me end where I started. You're gonna come out of this. I urge all of you, get up and eat something. They were scared, they were fasting, not a spiritual fast, a scared fast. You know those fasts. He broke up with me. Yeah, haven't eaten 6 days, that's a breakup fast. That's not no Jesus fast, praise God. Child in jail can't eat, that's not a Jesus fast. That's a I'm worried to death fast. They had one of them I'm worried to death fasts. Paul says, goodbye y'all, let's tear the church up. I recommend you eat something. You're gonna come out of this without even a scratch. Y'all just missed that. I'm preaching last point. Playoffs, 3 o'clock and 8 o'clock. Gotta go to dinner with everybody who helped with all these big old things we've had in a minute. Got a lot going on. You gonna come out of this without even a scratch. One more time. You're gonna come out of this. You know why I go to the Word Church? Because my pastor studies, he is trained, and he does respect the text. And my pastor is not sloppy, and my pastor is not interested in just emotions. I can trust him to be true to the text, to the best of his ability. You're gonna come out of this without even a stretch. Pastors, younger pastors, right now you're looking for a shout. So your next point would be, God told me to tell you that you're coming out of this and you're not even gonna have a scratch. See that? I got a woo. I got a woo. Paul was told by God to tell those people, you're gonna come out without even a scratch. That's not what God told me to tell you. Look at your neighbor and say, you're gonna get completely scratched up. Go ahead. But you're still gonna be all right. You're gonna be bloody. But when you come out of this, you're coming out with a smile on your face. I got a feeling. I said, I got a feeling. Would you look at somebody and say, neighbor, we gonna be all right. It may get dark sometime, but hold on to God's unchanging hand. We gonna be all right because weeping may endure for a night, but joy is coming in the morning. We gonna be all right because it has not yet appeared what we shall be, but we do know we shall be like him. We shall bump your neighbor and say, we gonna be all right because he that keeps Israel neither sleeps nor slumbers. Push somebody else and we gonna be all right because all things work together for the good of those that love him. Find two more people, point at them, say, we gonna be all right because I've been young and now I'm old. I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. Can I get a witness? I said, can I get a witness? I feel like preaching. Can I preach? I feel like preaching. I feel like preaching. Can I preach? Can I get a witness? And good evening, y'all. But if the Lord has kept your mind, I need somebody to jump on your feet and shake somebody's hand. Say, neighbor, it may be dark right now, but we gonna be all right. I got a word from the Lord that if you hold on, to God's unchanging hand, everything, will be all right. I gotta go, y'all. The game is coming on. But if you're not too mean, would you step in the nearest aisle and walk to somebody and say, neighbor, I know it's rough right now, but the Lord, I said, walk to somebody, reach to somebody. The Lord told me to tell you to keep your hand in the Lord's hand. He's able. Yes, he is. He'll make a way out of no way. If life has been rough, if your family's been funny, if your change has been strange, then help your pastor preach just one more time. Point at seven people, look them dead in the face, say, we gonna be all right. I got a feeling. Yes, sir. I got a feeling. I got a feeling that this too shall pass. All you got to do is keep on worshiping him. Keep on praising him. Tupac told me to tell you, keep your head up, because everything, great God. I feel God in this place. If you know he's all right, then shake your neighbor's hand like you're going to shake it off. Tell him, we going to be all right. We going to be all right. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We're going to be all right. I was here's my points. They'll flash them upstairs. I don't even have time to preach them. Pastoral experience teaches you when to get off the exit. So I got off at the exit. That might have been the last exit coming, so I got off, but here's what I would have gave you. We're gonna be all right as a family. I don't know what's happening up in that crib, but somebody not right. One cousin, one son. Do me a favor, please start at the Vernon house before you go to yours. Start at the Vernon house. We need prayer. We don't even try to let the smooth taste fool you. We are not all that. Life be happening with our family. We need your prayers right now. Everything is not what it seems. I mean, we do the best we can, but life is not perfect. We need help. Thank God, marriage off the chain. Most of the kids in church love you, but life happens. And God told me, for me and for you, your family gonna be all right. Somebody believe that. They gonna be all right emotionally. It's on the screens. mentally, your family gonna be all right emotionally, mentally, and financially. Somebody receive that. We're gonna be all right. We're gonna be all right emotionally, I mean that. Physically, financially, I mean that from my heart. I'm not just saying stuff I don't believe. We're gonna be all right as a ministry. I got so much faith. Telling somebody last night, 10 services a week. Me preaching all of them. I don't know how I didn't die. Bishop Joey says it was God that kept you. We having Founders Day, first Sunday in June, and I've learned to sit there at least every 2-3 years and just let people tell you that you've done all right. Everybody need a little bit of that. So I'm gonna bring somebody in to preach for me, and whatever, couple dollars, whatever happens, I'm gonna say, Lord, thank you. I was telling somebody, I'm 51, but really I'm 61 when you count all them services. I'm 61 in dog years, preaching years. Average pastor preaches one time. I did 7 or 8, trying to make sure we could be all right. And the pandemic taught us more. That you don't run nothing. That I put no confidence in the flesh. I used to have 5 of these, hear me, and the offering is better now than it was. Would y'all give God praise, everybody? My team will tell you, ask them. We don't owe nobody in the world except this building, and we got a plan, baby. Next door paid in full, 14 acres across the street paid in full, downtown paid in full, no local debt to nobody. We don't owe a soul nothing in the world. God did it. Not, why don't y'all give God? We gonna be all right. And to all of my members that are watching, come on home now. If you live in Cleveland, come on home. Come on now. You're going every place else. Come on home. Those that are watching virtually across the world, we gonna minister to you tonight. And we just want to do camaraderie, church spirit. I want you to wear clothes. This VF stands for Vernon Family, also the Vernon Foundation. This VF, Vernon Family, Vernon Foundation. This is just personal. I got an epiphany to stop making everybody else rich and wear my own clothes. That's just where I'm at. I'm not telling you not to do it. You'll see me in name brand stuff. I didn't bought too much of it. I got to wear it. Amen. But I ain't buying much more. And these VF, because y'all put up that W purse if y'all got that upstairs, Phil. Elder Drita, Lady Vernon gave Elder Drita this. Wave at me if we got it upstairs. Do we have it? Is that nice, everybody? Elder Drita sent me that. Lady Vernon gave her that. And Lady's not out. And so we about to get a bunch of those. I mean, sometime when you're just kicking it, put your W purse on. And come on, throw your hand up. Say, I receive that, Pastor. Amen. So we getting all colors. And that's not no sticker. That's embroidered, everybody. Y'all know we don't do nothing cheap. That's embroidered. That's a real W purse. Come on, clap your hands. And y'all ready for the W tennis shoes? I'll show them to you soon. And by the way, what advantage do we have on every business in the world? We're not trying to make money. That's a reason for going in business. The word store is just for you to have on some W stuff to represent Jesus. So I've told our team, put enough on it for the shipping and the cost. Let them win. I want you to just wear it. We're going to be all right. And then lastly, you're going to be all right personally. You're going to be all right ultimately and eternally. Everybody that's dealing with a disease, you're going to be all right. If you go to heaven, you're all right. If you live, you're all right. The enemy can't touch the believer. Jesus died for you. And so I called George at 11 o'clock. We ain't sung this in 10 years, but it's the only song that kept coming to my mind. Some of y'all remember it. As the praise team sings it, the altar is open. If there's something on your mind, don't nobody walk. We leave it in about 5 minutes, but everybody help the praise team sing it. Come on, y'all remember it. Everybody, come on, everybody. Everybody.
No matter what's going on.
To, but you gotta stay strong. I see you, brother. Come on, come on, come on. Be encouraged. Come on, shake my hand if something on your mind.
No matter what's going on.
Be all right, baby. It's gonna be all right.
He'll make it all right. But you gotta stay strong.
Be encouraged.
Be encouraged. Be encouraged.
Wow, such a powerful word.
Amazing.
Listen, we gonna
be all right.
Hey. And shout out to Kendrick Lamar for such an awesome term, because I'm believing Word Church. Like, we're going to be all right.
We are going to be all right. And I'm so grateful we have an amazing pastor that is studious, that's relevant, that brings it right to us.
Yes. Amen.
And after this pandemic and everything we went through, I know a lot of people are like, what? But we going to be all right.
All right. And I'm truly believing it. Hey, Word Church Nation, if you believe it too, make sure you subscribe, you comment, you like, and you make sure that you get connected with us.
Connected.
We want to connect with you.
Yes, we do. And on behalf of Dr. R.A. and Victory Vernon, we say farewell. Have an amazing rest of your day.
We'll see you next week.
Peace.